session of the Asbury Park City Council. Councilmember Chapman?
Here.
Councilmember Clayton?
Here.
Councilmember Kendall?
Here.
Deputy Mayor Quinn?
Here.
Mayor Moore?
Here.
Would everybody please rise for a silent prayer, a moment of reflection? Flag salute. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. As to comply with the Open Public Meetings Act, Chapter 231, Public Law 1975, adequate notice of this meeting has been provided in the following manner. The annual notice was forwarded to the Asbury Park Press, the Coaster and the Star Ledger on January 6, 2016, posted on a bulletin board the same day. All notices are on file with the city clerk. Items for review. City managers report on issues at prior council meetings.
Thank you, Madam Clerk. There's two issues that I'd like to address. At the last meeting, it was discussed that employees had gone out through the back door. That is untrue. It was one employee who was going to the post office. They did not leave early. We reviewed the timesheets. The second aspect is the exact figure on what has been repaid through the Community Development Block Grant Program. The number floated around was $280,000. Over the last roughly five years, the number is actually $240,000 that has been repaid for improper disbursements. That's all.
Move on to special event applications. Leisha?
Good evening, Mayor and Council. First application before you this evening is the Santa Run, which would be held on December 10th from 9 to 11.
I meant to Google it. This has nothing to do with SantaCon, right?
No.
It's a totally other event.
Yes. Next is a request from Triumphant Life Church to do the LIT encounter on Springwood Park on August 26th. And this is basically a community day from the hours of 7 to 9. Next is a prayer vigil that will be held on August 12th in Springwood Park, sponsored by CAN. The Boys and Girls Club will be doing their annual back-to-school community celebration, and they're seeking to close Monroe Avenue between Prospect and Wynn on August 27th between the hours of 12 and 3. The Asbury Park Music Foundation would like to add a concert to the concert series that's being held in Springwood Park. The date is not September 5th, but it's August 23rd, and it would be the Soul Cruises would be the additional concert added. The Jersey Shore Dream Team would like to use Springwood Park for a Christian concert and serving up some free hot dogs on September 3rd from the hours of 5 to 8. And the Greek Orthodox Holy Cross Day celebration this year will be held on September 18th. And they're seeking to use the beach, Fifth Avenue Beach, as well as Bradley Park for their annual event. And lastly, we have three weddings, one on September 25th on Second Avenue Beach, October 8th on First Avenue Beach, and August 14th on Sixth Avenue Beach. Any questions? Thank you.
No, just a minute, Lisa.
Yes, sir.
On behalf of the Asbury Park Recreation Committee, we just want to thank you. You did a fine job with the recreation program this summer, and all the committee members want to just say thank you along with the council.
Okay, thank you. And I do have to say the staff had a lot to do with that. We hired committed people who really care about our kids, so that made the program run smoothly. Thank you.
Great job.
Thank you.
Thanks, Lisa. Next is items to be presented. Michelle Alonzo, Director of Planning and Redevelopment, regarding amendments to the Central Business Development Redevelopment Plan.
Good evening. Thank you. Good evening,
council members and members of the public. I'm here to present to you some long-awaited amendments to the CBD redevelopment plan. This is a referral to the planning board. Once the planning board hears these, if council so chooses to forward them to the planning board, they would require two more hearings of council as an ordinance to be put into effect. You have seven amendments, and each one is labeled as an exhibit. Each one amends a different section of the plan. The first is Exhibit A, which is an amendment to the parking and circulation section of the redevelopment plan. The highlights of this is that it strikes some language that was in the plan that had deadline dates for the municipality that have passed. One included a deadline for the municipality to revisit the parking requirements of the CBD plan. Second revision is the codification of the ability to do interim parking. Right now, there has been some interim parking lots that were regulated by redevelopers agreement, yet the redevelopment plan did not have a provision in it to actually approve interim parking. But the biggest change that is proposed for the section includes bringing back changing the fee that would be required for a developer to submit for a structured parking space if they so choose not to develop a parking space on their actual property. Most of you know the background. Some of the public does not know the background. When this plan was initially adopted, the fee was $19,000. That is the actual cost of a structured parking space. The previous councils had brought that number down till now, where the number is 3,000, although that number was really never properly codified. So this brings it back to the fee of a structured parking space, which oddly enough, many years later, is very close. It's just a little under 20,000. Or if this council so desires, a different fee that they think is palatable to the development community. And that money will sit in an account to go towards structured parking sometime in the future. This council does not have to make a decision tonight as to what that cost would be. You would have in short order after passing this. And we would codify it, meaning that it would be codified either as an amendment to this plan or as a separate ordinance.
So what we would be voting on for Exhibit A is to potentially change the parking impact fee, although we don't have to pick the actual fee tonight.
No.
It's just a change.
Right, but we would have to do it in short order so that it piggybacks this ordinance change. And then another change to the section is a reaffirmation that accessory parking is accessory parking. What that means is accessory parking is the parking that is tied to a principal use in a zone. Currently, this redevelopment plan has a parking requirement for new residential and new commercial, and that if that parking is so developed, that has to be used by one of the principal users to which it's dedicated and cannot be leased as commercial parking. Commercial parking for the majority of this redevelopment plan is prohibited. So that's Exhibit A. Exhibit B is some general language that is for all the zoning sub-districts, which has the provision that if you have windows on the property line, the property next to yours, when it redevelops, cannot block those windows. Because what is permitted in the zone is zero lot line, but there are some buildings that historically, before modern building code, have windows on the lot line, And this is to preserve that no one's bedroom window gets blocked and no one, you know, loses all access to light and air as we redevelop the downtown. Exhibit C is more refined revisions to the zoning code for the specific Cookman Avenue Retail Core Subdistrict. As many people know, or maybe you don't know, that service uses are permitted on the ground floor throughout the redevelopment area except for Cookman Avenue. They're prohibited. So that means if you want to have a nail salon, a hair salon, a yoga studio, anything that's classified as use group service, you cannot have it on the ground floor on Cookman Avenue. I had gotten requests from various groups present in the downtown to revisit that and take a look at allowing service on the Cookman corridor. But at the same time, we want to maintain a lively storefront mix. So I'm proposing tonight, in order to achieve it, that 15 feet of depth of the storefront would have to be dedicated to retail, whether it's primary or accessory, and then a tenant or an owner can occupy the rest of the ground floor with a service use. Accessory means, for example, if you have the yoga studio and you wish to, and you sell mats, water bottles, videos kind of antiquated, you would do that as an accessory use within that area in the front window. It can also be a primary use, which is a secondary use, which is something that occurs in the downtown where we have an art gallery and a sub shop sharing the same space. So that's another way in which it could be achieved. And then what is not in the exhibits you have tonight, but is in my memo, is there has been a request for the building commonly known as the Passion Building at the Press Plaza. There has been a request for that to be all service. I had initially written it as this combination of 15 feet of retail, but the prospective tenant is asking that the building be zoned for an all service use.
So can I ask, do you want me to wait till you're done and then ask questions, or ask it while we're doing it via exhibit?
You can ask questions now.
So can you, a couple of questions. In Newark or Jersey City or where you're from, what services made downtown successful? Was it just one or was it a variety of them?
Well, a lot of downtowns do ban service, but they have a more robust retail mix and different floor plates. But I have to say, what you want in a service use is one where someone goes and does the service and then stays in the downtown to take advantage of another business. An example, going back to the yoga studio, that, you know, you would go do yoga and maybe you'll go do yoga with a friend and you'll stop and you'll get something at the juice bar. Or you will, as you come out of the yoga studio, say, hey, I got to go pick something up at a store down the street. Another example, which is funny enough, it would be a hair salon, but tends to be female, where females go, not males. You have more of a spin-off effect of where someone will get their hair done and say, let me do some of my other shopping or some of my other business in the downtown. The type of service you don't want is the one-stop service, and that tends to be a professional office or something where someone goes in and goes out. It's not permitted here, but a perfect example of that is medical office. Rarely do people go see their doctor and then do something after, because you're usually sick or you have a sick person with you, so you're in and out. But another example could be also like a tax preparation office. They have limited foot traffic throughout the year, and then when they do have foot traffic, it's not the type of foot traffic with spin-off effects. So what we are looking for is service with spin-off effects.
And so if service with spin-off effects would be retail in the front, or using the sandwich shop in the gallery, because that's kind of a good mix of a sandwich shop, and then there's also the gallery. So can you, and whoever wants the passion group, can you do spot, would we have to do something blanket that said 15 feet of retail and then the service, or can you spot it and do all service here, but everybody else has to be 15% of retail? It just feels a little chaotic to me not to have somewhat of one general theme throughout.
It's not 15%, it's 15 feet.
Right, so in a redevelopment plan, it's a good question, because one of the things people don't know is that in a redevelopment area, you are permitted to do spot zoning. In a regularly zoned area, you are not. And that was upheld by the courts that said when a municipality adopts a redevelopment plan, they're allowed to basically fine-tune the mix of uses that they want in that area to ensure revitalization. Now, saying that, is it very, very common? No, not really, because with a comprehensive plan like Cookman, that is why I had done it as a broad swath. But certain buildings may call for certain measures, especially if we want to fine-tune what the mix is in the downtown. Okay, so then the next section that I'm proposing amendments is the implementation of the redevelopment plan. Because this was originally written as if we were going to, I guess, do eminent domain, select developers, and designate developers. For the majority of the properties in the downtown, that has not occurred. There are bigger projects of which this council has designated developers and redevelopers agreements. But the majority of the property owners, they do not enter an agreement with us. So this language takes out the must, and even some language about an RFQ, which we're not doing, did not occur, and puts in language if we designate a redeveloper. So this is really a cleanup of this section. I also eliminated the reference to the TRC because it's my understanding, but I could be wrong, that this council has never sent any downtown project to the TRC. Okay, Exhibit E is definitions, arcade. This was a request from the zoning officer that because she actually would like us to refine our overall definition of the zoning ordinance for arcade, because it's a little archaic in that it still says coin-operated. While many arcades today, most are not coin-operated. You buy a card with money on it and use that, and there is the tendency for that to be a loophole. So what I did here is, in the redevelopment plan, I put the a more refined definition of arcade that is a more modern one than we have in the zoning ordinance. We will eventually amend the one in the zoning ordinance, although the planning board has requested that I don't do any major zoning changes till after we do a new master plan.
Well, that could be a year.
Yes. So, Exhibit F. Exhibit F speaks to, if we want to go forward with the amendment to have the service on Cookman, this is the map, the ground floor land use map, and this would add the words limited service to the chart. So this goes actually with the Exhibit C.
And then this was the part that wasn't in our packet, right?
Right, the omission. And then Exhibit G is a request by specific landowner who put a request into the council to be able to go up to 55 feet, five stories for their property. It is the bar that is across the street known as Johnny Mac's. And this is a request that I'm putting forward to you as part of this package because the developer has made the request. This is typically something I would not recommend because it does not further the interests of the public welfare, like some of the amendments that I'm presenting tonight. Most of this district is a four-story district. The building next door, the Savoy Theater, is taller, but it is the anomaly in the area. Again, is the up to the council whether they would like to recommend this package as a whole onto the planning board or only segments of it. So that is it in a nutshell. I know there are other, I'm sure there are other questions that some of you may have for me. I'm also open to suggestions.
So the idea, or no, go ahead.
I'm glad.
No, so the idea in 2003, when we did the Central Business mm-hmm. District, which was barren, was to rebuild it. So what the struggle that we're having now is obviously a huge amount of restaurants and bars, right, that interconnect in some odd way. And it seems like, so then correct me if I'm wrong, it seems like this would further the idea of several different types of businesses in the downtown. It would make it a little easier for retail because they could take on another gallery or whatever. And it'll take it from being what a little bit of what it's becoming, which is kind of like Restaurant Row. And in your experience, because I'll be honest, I don't leave Esbury, those are better downtowns from what I can tell when it's, you know, a restaurant and a bar, a retail shop, a gallery, a theater, a movie theater, whatever it is going down, if it's diverse as opposed to uniform of restaurants down the road.
Exactly, because what you have is a split economic development scene where you have a lot of restaurants and bars bring evening foot traffic. The retailers are daytime foot traffic. You want to bring people downtown during the day. Service is permitted in the redevelopment plan, not in the Cookman right. corridor, but we want to get better foot traffic down Cookman because you can go to get a massage on Bangs, but what we don't want you is to get into the car because Bangs doesn't have the same lively retail restaurant scene, has some, but it's not wall-to-wall like Cookman. We want you to, when you go to one use, when I say you, the retailer, do many uses in the downtown and do more of your spending downtown and have a more equal balance. And one of the things that's tipping us too much over is we, for better or for worse, have too lively a restaurant bar scene in the downtown. And that is, that's also driving rents up so that a restaurant / bar can pay a higher rent rather right. than a service or a retail use. So we need to swing it back a little bit so that we have the right mix of uses in the corridor to keep people on the corridor and spending in multiple places. Some of the thinking in retail is that you may want to create some very subsect commercial zones, like an entertainment zone. But we don't really have that here. If we were going to do that, then that would be the only zone. And our retail is suffering a little bit because the restaurant bar mix is tilting it a little bit too much.
Okay. Michelle, yes. Would you say that maybe 60 or 70% of the people that shop downtown is from out of town?
I don't have those numbers, but I would say that you have a mix because you do have residents who shop downtown, but you also have tourists who hear about Asbury and do frequent some of the restaurants or take a walk down Cookman, and they do buy from the downtown. But you definitely have residents, buying from the downtown. And definitely using the services that are there, whether it be whether it is the nail salon that's there or the hairdressers or the acupuncture or the massage parlor.
I understand.
And then parlor is the wrong word. Massage therapy.
How
yes.
How do we manage this so we don't end up with 4 yoga studios on Cookman Avenue or 5 hair salons on Cookman? How is that managed then when you start to spot zone?
You see, that's the tricky part. What other municipalities have done is when it starts to tip that way, like you have like 3 nail salons within so many feet of each other, they say you can only have one every 200 feet, every 1,000 feet. And that is something if we could visit now or we can even visit in the future if we feel then it's tipping too much towards service.
But if we require the 15
feet.
The idea of requiring the 15 feet of retail would at least curb that a little bit.
Right, because that, so right, so then you have the you have at least a retail presence at the storefront, and that would be consistent up and down Cookman, and then the service is in the back. But I kind of know what Eileen means, because I made it at 15 feet trying to be flexible. You can still get a bunch of nail salons, and then you may have minor retail fronting Cookman. It's, the thing is, we're not sure what we would necessarily get in the mix as we progress forward. We have in our office gotten numerous requests of barbershops and hair salons wanting to come on Cookman. And that's because, and that's for some of the smaller spaces where they're very small for anything except convenience retail. And it doesn't, and also too small to pique the interest of a cafe or a restaurant. But saying that some, you know, one of those spaces that actually got rented and transformed is the cigar shop. So there's a niche. Cigar shop found its niche in that square footage. It came, it moved in.
So do some of those smaller spaces actually have the 15 feet plus additional feet?
They may not, but I picked the 15 feet and rather than a percentage because it was, if I open, you know, I go into the shop, how much of that front, more about the frontage rather than the percentage. Mm-hmm. And we may, you know, we may not be the right fit. And we may revisit it.
I like your idea of saying so many per 100 feet or so many per block. And I think I'd rather do that at the beginning than the end.
Yeah.
So I'd rather do that.
Okay.
Then correct that after we're like, oh my, we have 8. Now how do we stop number 9 and 10?
I can come back with that revision.
Okay. I think you've done an excellent job. I know your numbers sometimes were higher. I totally thank you for being flexible. A couple questions. Exhibit E. Arcades. And
yes.
This goes back probably before you were hired. This goes back before, like, you know, an arcade is an arcade. A 10,000 square foot restaurant with 5 games charging a quarter to me is not an arcade. I mean, we're blowing it here, and we're not being consistent as far as how it's being enforced. If we don't like you, we shut you down. If we do like you, we just turn our backs. So it's something, again, it's been like brought up right before you were hired, and it's just been deep sixed, and we've never addressed it. It's something that's got to be addressed. But I mean, I owned a restaurant on the boardwalk. I had 15 pinball machines, and it was totally legal. I went bankrupt because I bought it in before the town came back. But why should I be limited on, like, just because you got to put a quarter or 50 cents or a credit card into a machine? Again, I'm not talking about, like, you know, if you're going there for a dinner, there shouldn't be, like, loud games next to you. But there are already, and we're overlooking that, and we're picking on, in my guess, we're picking on 2 or 3 people instead of being consistent. And as far as, again, if I have I don't even know what a 10,000 square foot building is, but if I have a 50,000 square foot building and I can only have 3 games that take quarters, to me that's ridiculous. So that's just my personal feeling. As far as, and I don't know how we're going to vote on this, I'm going to say probably separately, because you're right, somebody's asking to go to 55 feet, in which I don't know how many feet they're at now.
Well, what's permitted for the zone is 45.
45, so they're asking you to go another 10 feet.
Right, another
well, can
story.
Can we just stay on Exhibit E for a second? Since
okay, go ahead.
You moved on.
Yep.
So with the arcades, and where did the number 4 come from?
Well, it came from our current zoning ordinance, and what I did was I just changed the coin operated. But this
right.
we can either strike this, or we can re-examine the number that constitutes an arcade.
And then the ones that are existing in the downtown that are over 4, if there are any, are they grandfathered in or no? Because there was a previous ordinance of 4. So you're saying there's a current ordinance of 4 right now on
yes.
the coin operated machines.
Yes.
Okay, I got you.
And you correct me. I was every planning board meeting, every meeting, I was told it was 3. So have we went
yeah,
from 4 to 3? I'm happy. We increased 1, but
I will double check that because
okay.
that.
And can you see where the 4 came? It just seems like a random number. Where the 4 came from? Like what? Who picks 4?
I mean, I was again. My goal with this
was
what,
to fix the coin operator.
Right, and that's the thing. That was a chance. If you want to up the number for this zone. Of what constitutes an arcade, now's the chance.
Well, that's where I would go, like, and it's going to be tough. So many per square feet or
yeah.
so much this. I mean,
good.
Right. I mean, if you
okay.
have 10,000 square feet, you shouldn't have 100 games. But, I mean,
right.
if you have 10,000 square feet, could you have 6 or 7? And again, I don't even know what 10,000 square feet equates. I don't know how big is this room as far as square footage. But it's just like, I know we have some establishments right now that have more than 3 or 4. They're not a hindrance to anybody except like, it's against a stupid old law that we have never had the guts to tackle. And again, it goes back before you.
Right, so that's why I'm saying if you want, or we don't have to, but if you want for this zone to liberalize it, we could do that.
I would like to liberalize it just because, I mean, it's not like that's where they're making their bread and butter. It's an enmity to like whatever it is to like, you know, here, you want to come and have fun and you're tired of sitting and drinking a beer. Let's go play skee ball. Let's go throw darts. Let's do something. And half these games you only have to pay for.
I would recommend just keeping this as is so that the definition can get updated to today's standards. And then as we revisit it over the next month or so, then we can make a bigger and larger change. But this just updates the definition, which is important right now.
So what's going to be the process? We're going to go through each of these exhibits and look at them individually and then vote on them individually? Are we going to do this as...
That's a package.
As Michelle has given it to us.
Well, remember also, you're not taking any action this evening. And the vote that you would take would be on Wednesday to refer any or all of these proposed amendments to the planning board for their review and recommendation back to you, at which point you would have to introduce and adopt an ordinance to effectuate these plan changes. At this point, these are concepts that you're referring to the planning board so that they can be fine-tuned further and then sent back to the mayor and council for an ordinance in the future.
Would that take place this coming Wednesday or at the following?
No, you would potentially be taking action this Wednesday to refer any or all of these proposals to the planning board. The proposals are A through F or G. A through G, excuse me.
Okay.
And you can, based on Michelle's recommendations, refer any or all of them through the resolution that was part of the public packages that's on the agenda for Wednesday.
So I'm going to go back to the other one. I don't even know what exhibit it is, where somebody asked to go 10 feet higher.
G.
G?
No.
Yes.
Is it a G?
G?
G.
Okay. Yeah, G. You say besides the Savoy, it's an anomaly, but we just put out an RFP to make this building and this lot 8 stories, which is a lot more than 55 feet. So it's no longer going to be an anomaly. So, I mean,
well, one of the reasons we did that with this RFP is because we're trying to get structured. We're trying to get a lot on the lot. We're trying to get structured parking.
I understand that. And the person who asked to go another 10 feet is trying to get a lot on their lot. And it kind of goes back to the something that I was laughing about before. I didn't pay a lot of attention in school, but I mean, it was laissez-faire. I mean, leave business alone. I mean, a policy of letting things take their own course without interfering and without anarchy, with rules and regulations. But sometimes, as many times as we hear about Asbury Park has come back organically, where it hasn't happened because of what we've done. It's happened because of business here, business there, business there. And I'm a firm believer, and like, you know, maybe the business people know more than I know. And if somebody needs another 10 feet to make their business successful, I'm going to say, okay.
But that's why we have zoning. And, you know, anyone then can, you know, can make the request to go higher.
Right. And that's why I'm going to ask to be voted on separately, because I have no problem with another 10 feet on any building, be it on that corner, on any quarter in the downtown, just because we're talking about the beachfront where we're talking about going 17 stories. I mean, so what is the difference between the CBD? I know there is a lot. And again, I'm not faulting you whatsoever. I think you've done a great job with a tough subject that you had to, like, take over and try to make some sense of, because there was no sense of it before. But that's just my opinion.
And council can take one vote referring the proposals that Michelle has identified as A through G en masse over to the planning board, or you can take individual votes as you see fit to refer them individually over to the planning board.
Okay, and just do me a favor, between now and Wednesday, shoot us an email with, like, A means this, B means this, C means this, D means this, and it's just a little brief sentence, so we all know what we're voting on.
So we're voting on each exhibit individually.
That's at council's discretion. If that's what you would like to do, you can have separate resolutions for each.
No, I have no problem.
All right.
I just feel this way. If it's not broke, why try to fix it?
Because it is a little broken.
But
from what I've heard, well, since, you know, since I started here, I've had various people, you know, say one of the priorities that I was told and I was given was amend CBD, fix CBD. Mm-hmm. And one of the things, so CBD has had 14 amendments since it was adopted in 2003, but they were all very lot specific and very piecemeal. There has not been a comprehensive relook added, because now it's 15 years old, more, 17 years old. And so it was written for Asbury Park in 2003. And from what I've been hearing from various factions in the city is that it is a little broken. It's a little
right,
broken.
So we update.
Yeah. Is that it? Is that good?
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
All right, we'll move on to review of agenda items for Wednesday night's meeting.
I didn't finish because I was going through the last minute emails on this today, so I'll finish tomorrow.
I can just go through them.
If I have any questions.
Do you just want me to go through them?
Do what?
Do you just want me to go through them, the resolutions?
If you're going to do that, then do it every meeting. But I mean,
it's your call.
Does anybody have any questions? I had some questions. I talked to Michael today. My questions have mostly been answered. So if you want to go through them all, but then I'm going to say, do that every meeting. Okay. Questions.
Michael, have one question. Resolution 2016-349. It's the memorandum with the agreement of the New Jersey Office of Emergency Management. So does this only apply when there is emergency like Sandy, or what's really
Excuse
the
me.
Focus?
Kevin.
currently, the Asbury Park Fire Department has four members that volunteer with New Jersey Task Force One. New Jersey Task Force One is one of those statewide teams, you see them all over the country, that respond to catastrophic emergencies like 9/11, Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans, Sandy, earthquakes in Port-au-Prince, Haiti, things like that. So New Jersey Task Force One came into existence in 1995, and for 20 years they've been trying to get FEMA designation. It's a statewide team. They just recently were designated as one of the 28 federal teams in the country, and as such, they have to redo all of their paperwork and all of their agreements. So in short, what this means is we are now eligible to be reimbursed for any costs we incur when our members get deployed to these catastrophic emergencies. That's all that is. So it's a good thing.
Oh, it's a good thing. Thank you.
And who are the, just because it is a great thing, and there's only 160 in the state, or how many?
There's 20, there's 28, there's 28 teams, and in New Jersey, I think it's six, there's three 63-person teams associated with Task Force One, because they only deploy a third of it at a time, so they're always ready, and one's always resting. So,
and we have
four Asbury Park firefighters: four. Robert Fonholz, James Hammond, Christopher Barkelow, and Paul Annunziata are our members that are assigned to this team.
And all four of them should be thanked and commended for. They don't get paid extra for this. They do it because they love their job, and so it's great for the state. It's great for Asbury. So. I personally thank you. It's the refunding of the bonding, and this is good because we're taking all old debts and combining them through the MCIA. And what is the projected savings to the city?
Approximately $48,000 to $90,000, depending on what the final rate will be over a 5 or 10 year period, more than likely 10 year period. So it will be a savings. These ordinances were passed a couple months ago. This is just a continuation to allow us to go forward with it.
Thank you. Okay. And this, again, I talked to Michael earlier. The audit report recommendations. Number 8 was important, but number 13 to me was more important. Like, we have no backup to our emails or anything, so that's something like we're working on immediately to get solved tomorrow.
We've known it's been a problem. If the council at the 2 or 3 meetings ago had approved the authorization for the capital ordinance for IT work, this is going to be paid for that. I had a conference call with one of our hardware vendors on Friday about how to fix this. We presently have 4 servers, and I met with staff today, 5 if you count the fire department, which is the worst server we have, and I'm not even counting police. So I talked with them. I talked with staff today about who's doing what where. It's a hodgepodge, but we're going to try to make it all into one inclusive fix. Hopefully we have something done by the end of the month.
And then going back to the resolutions for the footbridge, one is to increase the maybe cost, and one is to hire T&M as the consultant, be it overseer of the project. Both of those are 90% reimbursable by FEMA.
Yes, that's correct.
Okay, now a question as far as the cost for the footbridge, and we've had discussions between myself, individuals, and the business and everything. The quotes that we put out said to drive the piles 50 foot deep. Now, people that I've talked to said, that's not gonna happen, that's impossible. So if they only drive them 25 feet, do we get a reimbursement?
we would get a reimbursement depending on what happens at the time. If the piling, if the piles have to be cut, that's one thing, but then we'll know from future that we can get this, the shorter piles. So it's going to depend on where in the process they are and what happens. There's an, actually an engineering manual that delineates what size piles you must use. So years ago, the piles there would have been 25 feet, but under the new specifications, which I think are 2 years old, the piles have to be 50 feet.
But if they run into bedrock or something like that, they can only go down 25
then
the, feet.
Then there's a change order.
We would get a change order to our favor.
Yes.
And when and if this lake is dredged, what does that do to the depth of those pilings then?
Absolutely nothing, because you would dredge around it.
Okay.
That's all I have.
Matters by the City Council.
I have some two items. On Friday night at 6 o'clock at the Springwood Avenue Park, there's going to be a citywide prayer vigil, and we're asking everyone to please come out. It starts promptly at 6 and it's over by 7 o'clock. So we're asking the community to please join us in the prayer vigil. And second, I don't know if you've seen the newspapers, but last week, July 28th, the city was very fortunate in receiving two grants from HMFA for the development of properties on Springwood Avenue. The first is the Renaissance Project, and that was millions of dollars. And the second is the Boston Way Project, and they were awarded $12.1 million. So about $19.1 million is coming to the city for those two projects, but the total cost of the projects when they're completed will be closer to $70 million. So there's $70 million in development funds that are coming to Springwood Avenue in the very near future, and it's going to end up with 120 units of low income and middle income in the Boston Way Project, and the Renaissance Project will have 64 one, two, and three bedroom units along with commercial space and commuter rooms and other services for the residents. So it's a good day for Asbury Park.
Mine is not as exciting. APTV is putting on a free editing workshop for people. We're putting it on August 23rd from 6:30 to 8. The APTV committee, which are all volunteers, as most of you know, obviously is passionate about getting the community involved. So we will be showing people how to do basic editing, inputting, outputting, getting things up on YouTube. So it's a free workshop from 6:30 to 8, run by the committee of APTV, which is, for those of you that don't know, is the Asbury Park's public broadcasting network for all intents and purposes.
It does a great job.
Last week, National Night Out was another success this year. And I've got to really give a big shout out to the police department, Alicia, Cassandra, and the people that worked so hard to bring this about every year. I was able to give out 7, 8 bicycles, and it was just amazing to see the kids' faces. They couldn't wait to get up there to get their bicycles. And every year, this is growing. I see that it's growing more and more, more participants. So I'd like to thank those people once again and look forward to next year. Thank you.
I'd just like to remind everyone that there's a concert tonight in Springwood Park. If you want to go when this is over, it's Monte Rosa, a great Latin band.
So if nobody asks any questions, talking about concerts, the concert added August 23rd. Bouncing Souls?
Soul Cruisers. They offered to come in to do a free concert for the city. They wanted to specifically do a concert on Springwood Avenue.
And it's great, and I got to thank Eileen. Without Eileen, this would not have happened. Without Angel Camus, this would not have happened. So I got to thank Angel. I got to thank Eileen, and we were able to get it onto the series. It's a Tuesday night, and this is a big band.
Yes.
That draws thousands, and it's free. It's open to the public. So this is big. This is something you would go to the Stone Pony and pay for. So, Eileen, thank you to make it happen.
Glad to do it. Thank you.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Court collection, any update from the people waiting for to hear, like, when they're going to tell us yay or nay?
I've started putting together the RFP. They're going to, the state's going to want to review that. I'm waiting for three other towns to send me the Word document so we can make some copy and paste changes. Hopefully, we should have that out by the end of the month.
Okay. As much as the governor's frozen all road work and everything, and it looks like we'll probably be frozen until after, we probably have to go back out to bid, but are you still playing phone tag from DOT as far as Steiner Place?
Yes, we called each other three times on Thursday. My last call was with one of the deputies who said that they're gonna, I finally got a hold of someone. I was talking, trying to get the director. I got one of the deputies. They're gonna look into it, and they asked us to give us a couple weeks because of August and vacations.
Okay.
So once September rolls around, I'll start calling them again.
That's all I have. Thank you.
Well, I just want to ask something. Would you just please stand up and show your recreational shirts and all these two was participating in the rec? Just say hi, turn around, hi, let everybody see you. All right, thank you.
Yeah, because we called on you. Go ahead.
I'm sorry.
Thank you. I said thank you from the other kids because they enjoy so much. And we don't have the opportunity for to do what you do, right? So I come only for that, to say thanks a lot for everything what you're doing for the kids.
Did you have a good time? Yeah. Were you on the bus that broke down? No.
He was.
You were? Okay. It was a great recreation season, and thank you so much for coming out and thanking us. But
really, they're working all in the year and in the school for that. Let's make it good, not for going to the campaign where you doing every year. So thank you very much.
Well, you can all, we can all do it, like on the back of the shirts or the sponsors. We can all send them a letter, say, thank you, give again. But no, thank you. Instead of you staying all night, thank you.
And maybe if you stop by and see Hannah, she'll just grab a picture in your names.
With Leisha.
With Leisha.
Yeah. Yep.
That'd be great. You can go do it now.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Take your time to attend tonight. Michael?
Matters from the city manager.
Just want to have a reminder that the other August meeting has been canceled, the one for the last week of the month, and the next one will be in September.
Did we get the generator that we were getting for City Hall yet, Michael?
Tomorrow. No, it's not tomorrow. We finished our contract discussions. They're going to get their subs together. We're going to have a pre-construction meeting within 2 weeks. It's going to take a while to obviously get the generator here. Hopefully by the end of the year, everything's up and running. It's waiting for parts at that point in time.
If we could get it before winter hits, right?
It would be ideal.
But it's a done deal on our end. The money's there.
Yeah, it's just now we need pre-construction and permitting and they order.
Review of the grant writer request for proposals.
Oh, yeah. On the agenda is a resolution that we're requesting. We had an RFP out for grant management, grant writing services. We had it open-ended where we can appoint multiple consultants as need be. We were looking for a broad swath of individuals. For example, one firm might be better in arts, one firm might be better in FEMA, one might be better in infrastructure. So reviewing the proposals, these three firms had enough qualities that we were looking for that we're asking to appoint all three with an amount not to exceed $20,000. If we need to do something, move forward, you'll be notified of it, but this allows us to move quickly when we see some things. Thank you.
Matters by the city attorney?
I have no matters to address right now.
All right, can I have a motion to open the meeting up to the public?
Move it.
Second.
All in favor?
Yes.
All opposed? Public is expected to conduct themselves in a proper manner. Any derogatory, abusive, or threatening statements will not be permitted. The chair will immediately rule such conduct out of order, and after appropriate warning, may terminate any further comments from the speaker. Each speaker has 3 minutes to speak, and when you come up to the mic, please state your name and address for the record, please.
Good evening, Mayor and Council. I just have a little information for you about arcades. I sat on the zoning board when Silver Bowl Museum appeared. You may remember they were originally on Cookman Avenue. And all of that is controlled by state statute. And if one person stands in front of a machine, deposits money, and is rewarded, it's considered an arcade. That's the reason the Silver Bowl place is a museum. He had to retrofit all those machines so that they would not award prizes. And a ticket that says prize on it, or, you know, 5 cents or whatever, is a prize. So I'm sure that Cindy could figure this out in a blink. It's Title 13, Chapter 3 of the State Administrative Code. Thank you.
And why did they pick 4, Pam?
That appears to be arbitrary on the city's part.
Good evening, Mayor and members of the governing body. My name is George McGill. I'm an attorney. I represent 208 Realty LLC. The principal is John McGillian. I have here with me tonight, we're here because we are the applicant who asked to go up 10 feet. I'm here, I have a resolution, an ordinance in fact, from the governing body in reference to 601 Madison Avenue, which in fact was a building that was 60 feet high that was permitted to go to 70 feet high. And I'd like to give that to the governing body for your reference when you're considering Section G of the amendments. And in the ordinance itself, it says the board recommends, the planning board, that the proposed building height of 70 feet be permitted since it is consistent with the height of contiguous structures next to the site. So that's the same thing that we have going on right here. We have the Savoy building right next to us. It's taller than us. It's at 5 stories. We only want what they have, and we want to be contiguous and consistent with that height. And this is an ordinance that in the past this city has considered and, in fact, granted. When I came here tonight just for Section G, but I looked at the amendments in general, and it seems like there's at least 3 of these amendments that directly affect my client. The first is the parking. My client has been before the planning board, and we needed something like 22 parking spaces that we had to kick money into the fund. And it was $3,000. So we were at something like $60,000 plus, which is a lot of money. So when you're dealing with 20 parking spaces, if you're going to kick it up to $20,000, you're up to $400,000, close to $500,000. When you do that, you're just going to kill the development in the city. You can't put something at $20,000. The $3,000 is a lot of money and painful in itself. Mm-hmm. Now, the window issue is an amendment that's asking for a property owner to give his property up because of another property owner's use. Now, when you build out to a lot line, they're called lot line windows. You know, sooner or later, somebody else can build up just on the lot line, just like you. Okay, it's the same thing. So now this is going to be put into effect, and it's going to affect my client. I'd like to know what other applications are before the city, other than my clients, that actually this is going to pertain to. But you, as a governing body, can put in a grandfather clause. We've already filed for a new application, so you could put in a grandfather clause that, same as the municipal land use law, when you file an application, you go by those ordinances in effect at the time. You can do the same thing. And obviously, I'm running out of time. But the arcade issue is an issue directly written for my client. I think you understand that. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, John McGillan. I just want to bring up a couple of things. I hope I'm not redundant. The arcade, Don Samet, before he left, he spoke about he had a plan for increasing the games in the city, and I'm sure you can all get the report and find out what it says. And And if you didn't okay his plan, you should have some form of, you know, somehow cut it down or increase it or whatever you have to do. Another thing regarding iStar in the city, the redevelopment. We're down on Kingsley Street in Kimmeries, and not only do we have a bar with a building, but the other bar, the other building next to the bar, we can't take it down. We can't throw it in the garbage. Besides that, we have a second floor that was residential at the time, and we can't throw that in the garbage because of this redevelopment zone business. And on top of that, we can't build up. You know, the bar, the way it is now, it's 3,000 or 4,000 square feet, and that's not competitive. You can't operate with 3,000 or 4,000 square feet. That's like a New York City bar, 25 by 100, it's nothing. So we need some kind of relief, both with the games, with the amendment to the redevelopment plan, on those two issues. Anyway, I have a third issue, and I want to comment regarding the lady that spoke and her paragraph G. And if anybody has a copy of it, she refers to one building that's 5 feet, 5 stories in this block and lot. That's not true. There's two buildings in that block and lot that are 5 stories. One of them might not have a CO for it. It's in the process of being built. But there's two buildings. And for a woman of that caliber to get up there and make a mistake like that, that's not appropriate. That's not appropriate. Okay. And then she refers to Main Street and Lake Avenue. And I don't know why that came into the picture with 6-story buildings. And she excused that it was okay to be over on Lake Avenue with 6 stories. But we're not asking for 6 stories. We're asking for 5. In the meantime, she made reference to the size of the streets between Lake Avenue and Main Street. She was wrong by 20 feet. She said that Lake Avenue was bigger by 20 feet. It turns out that Main Street is bigger by 20 feet. So somebody should give her a ruler before she comes up here again.
Okay, so time's up.
Is my time up?
Oh, yeah, time's up.
Fuck, I wasn't looking at the time.
We're putting a building up because there's tenants there, residential tenants, and we want to put the building up in front of them so there's no noise problem.
Okay.
So there's no noise problem.
Okay, your time's up.
Excuse me, one more time.
Okay, Andy, address.
What did you call me?
Andy, address the chair, please.
If I may, Andrew Karras from the firm Fox Rothschild. I'm an attorney. I represent Carter Sackman, Sackman Enterprise, and the various companies that are related. In terms of raising the height of the building to 5 stories for the Johnny Mac property, my client is against it. We concur with the assessment of Ms. Alonzo. There's no reason for it. And in doing so, you're not taking into account adjacent property owners. In effect, what you're doing is disregarding your adjacent property owners, and you're blocking the light and the air of apartments that are going to be constructed. The entire view, all the light in the air, would be prohibitive if any building was constructed 5 stories on the adjacent site. So for that reason, we object to it, and we don't think it's good planning. Again, we concur with the assessment of Ms. Alonzo. Next, there are a few things that were stated with regard to the CBD plan. I do agree with the assessment that was given by Mr. McGillian's attorney with regard to the $20,000. I think we had, from what I recall, is around $19,000 or so before what the amount was. If you look at what was collected on that, I think it was pretty much zero. It stifled development. I don't think it would push forward any development in this city. If anything, it would restrict development. I think it's a bad idea because of that. The $3,000, which is being assessed now, is still a lot. However, it is being paid. There are funds that are being collected, and it is reasonable. Beyond that would be unreasonable. There's also a statement with regard to, or proposed with regard to accessory parking, that the principal use of the parking lot must use the assigned principal use and can, or let me rephrase that. Accessory parking spaces that are a requirement of this plan must be utilized by the principal user of the parking lot. The assigned principal use cannot be used as commercial parking. One problem that you're going to have with that, say you have an apartment building and it's required to have 40 parking spaces. However, only 20 residents of the entire building have cars and say they have 20 cars. What you're going to be left with are 20 empty spaces, spaces that could be utilized for retail uses within the downtown area. Not everybody has a car today. That's a reality. A lot of young people don't have cars today. That's a reality. The proper way to address it is through the permitting process. Right now what the city does is they allow residents within the downtown, all of them, to have parking permits. However, if you have in a unit, an apartment unit within a building that has available parking available to you, if you take away that right to have a permit, then they would be utilizing the parking on site. From there, you can determine if there are parking spaces that aren't being utilized, they can then go to any commercial uses and make that available to then net increase the amount of parking within the district. My time is up. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm just going to make two comments, just so everybody understands in the audience. We are not voting on what the parking impact fee is. We know it once was 19. We know it's now 3. It's probably going to be somewhere in between those two numbers, but that isn't particularly something we're working on. And I just want to clarify about the amendment meeting, John. We had a meeting set up with ISTAR, set up for Tuesday, July 28th. ISTAR canceled it Monday. The Monday before the Tuesday meeting to go over the amendments. And just so everybody else knows, this council passed lot by lot development. In order to get anything passed, you have to mutually agree on it. ISTAR said no to lot by lot, not us. We all uniformly agreed in lot by lot development. I don't know what they're selling. I wasn't at their homeowners meeting, but it is absolutely incorrect. We all voted for lot by lot and they said no.
Good evening, Mayor, Deputy Mayor, Council Members, General Public. My name is Clarice Brown, and on a lighter note, I just want to piggyback on the Asbury Park Recreation, the excitement of the family that spoke to you a little while ago. I have grandchildren that have attended the recreation for the past 3 years, and I also have grandchildren in Red Bank, in Neptune, and in Asbury Park. And the Asbury Park Recreation Summer Camp is by far the best. I just wanna reiterate that. The activities, the friendships that carry on from year to year are something that these children will carry with them forever. The staff is phenomenal. And it is by far the most reasonably priced summer camp in the area as well. So I don't know exactly who funds it, but I just want to encourage the continuation of this program and just know that it's doing wonders for our children in this community. Thanks for the privilege
of
addressing
you.
You can thank Alicia. Jesse's in charge of the recreation committee, but it's a city effort, and it really is. And we asked people to step up to the plate and donate, and they did donate. And I have a problem with one speaker coming up where they said it's the best camp in Monmouth and Ocean County, and I said no, it's the best in the state of New Jersey.
That's right. That's right.
It was great, another great year, and last week, it was just so great to be over there and see everybody having such a great time. But again, thank the staff. So, and that's one thing we said from day one, recreation will never be cut, no matter how broke we are. Yes.
I'm Janice Hughes. I'm the summer coordinator for recreation. And for the last 22 years, I've seen it has really, really made a difference. We have students from kindergarten through high school who actually benefit from our recreation department. In high school, we actually, our camp hires some of our city youth to, so they can be trained as counselors one day. We have kindergarten and preschoolers who are coming away from their parents for the first time, and they love our program. So I want to say thank you from the bottom of my heart. I remember camp when I was here as a young child growing up. I went to our camp here. So for me to be a part of giving back to the community, it does me well. Last Friday was amazing. I actually cried for the first time in front of the kids. But it was very emotional for me because to look at where I grew up, because I grew up right across the street from where our new Springwood Avenue Park is, for me to be sitting there with 225 kids coordinating an event that big, it was amazing. So I really, really, really thank you for the park. That park is amazing. And I will do anything that you need me to do to keep that park clean and going because it is the best thing on the west side right now. So I thank you guys for that park. And I thank you for supporting recreation. The rodeo was amazing. We need to do that again, too. Thank you.
And thank you for all your hard work. You're welcome. And all the counselors.
You're welcome. Thank you. My right hand, Leisha Floyd.
Tracy Rogers, Monroe Avenue. With the redevelopment, which Michelle alluded to, many cities adopt their own mixture of what they want in their city, and the legislative body and the planning board are very constructive in that. Go to Jersey City. Jersey City last year made an ordinance where in their downtown, you can only have 15 to 20% big box stores, and most of it had to be mom and pop. Those are things that regulate to what is going to happen in a city. So you have to direct your thought process to what you believe is going to be the right mix for the city, and you have the right to authorization to do that because you're going to look at it 10 to 15 years down the road, what is the city going to look like? So the best offering is not what you think is working, because business owners are out for a profit. They can come in and take advantage of anything and don't have to do it, but you have to look at the city and what the vision of the city is actually looking to do. Also, the parking ordinance needs to be examined because, as I've seen, there is an issue with the parking, but cohesive thinking and sitting together the plan, you're going to come up with something. Not everybody's going to like what you come up with, but it has to be fair and equitable to everyone in that process. Right now, there was a RFP put out on the workforce development. I haven't heard anything on meetings as to community input and what we're looking to do. I think that our RFP went out in April or May. I just wanted to know what was going on with that. And like I said, the initial, these ordinance that you're looking at on the redevelopment are essential. And each of those things that were brought up quintessentially will develop the city and put it into a vision. And right now you guys have that control on that vision. So I'm just saying, don't take it lightly.
Michael, do you have a response for the update?
We can't award it until we pass the budget, which, as transitional aid, we can't pass the budget until we get a transitional aid number, which right now, whenever we ask anyone in the state, they say, we don't know. So the it hasn't even been awarded yet to start any process. The firm that responded has fantastic references. I'm going to recommend award. Can't do anything until we get a budget passed, and who knows when that's going to be.
Hi, my name's Allison Coffin. I work for James W. Higgins. We're at 823 West Park Avenue in Ocean Township. I'm a professional planner. I've been working with Johnny Mack as they've developed their redevelopment plans for this parcel. That's the now infamous Exhibit G. Before I go any further, Mr. McGill has asked me if I would make sure it's okay for him to bring up that resolution that he offered to give you, but did not yet. Would that be acceptable to the council?
I don't know what you're talking about, so finish your 3 minutes.
Okay. Well, what I want to do is provide some, shed some light on the public benefit to what the redeveloper is proposing, since there's been some discussion that there may or may not be public benefit to that additional 10 feet of height. What we have are structures that are being proposed between a beer garden, restaurant, and reception facility and residential apartments. And having that extra story will provide a more thorough screen for both the light and sound that the reception and beer garden facilities will be generating. So I think there's a public benefit to the residents of the building to the immediate east. But beyond that, this property, which is located on Main Street between Madison and Cookman, is one of the more visually important pieces within this district. It's one of the first things that people see when they come into Asbury via train. They're going to step out of the train and they look at this frontage on Main Street. Now, what I have the advantage of seeing, but the council does not in a 3 minute presentation, is the renderings that the applicant is proposing for the architecture for this property. And what the applicant is proposing is going to create a stunning visual character for this block. There's two stories up on Main Street, then you have the beer garden sunk in behind that, and then the five stories behind it create more visual depth than even a four-story structure would, and it creates a gateway for the southern entrance or the eastern entrance to this part of Asbury Park. So I think there's a substantial public benefit to that extra 10 feet, both in terms of protecting the residents east of this property and in terms of promoting a more desirable visual character to this part of the city.
We got renderings.
Oh, you did?
I believe.
Yes.
From Michelle, just FYI.
Okay. Well, then you know what I'm referring to. And that's all I have.
Okay. Thank you. Rita?
Hi, Rita Moreno, 8th Avenue. I was wondering if we could get a beach bathing report for June and July and a parking report. We usually get those every year. We haven't gotten them this year.
What's the second thing you asked for, Rita?
Parking.
Oh,
what?
Parking.
Parking.
Okay. I didn't hear you. Okay.
Okay. For June and July. Can we have those by Wednesday?
No.
Okay. And the other thing I wanted to talk
about. That was the easiest no of my life. Let me explain. Go ahead. Baby. I'll explain after. Go ahead.
But don't take up my minutes now.
Okay. I'll give you another 15 seconds.
What? Okay.
No, go ahead. What? Yeah. Keep on going.
Okay. I don't know if everybody saw the Coast on page 10. Henry wrote a letter about I call it the bridge gate now, because that's what it is. It's a little bridge. It's not even a bridge, and we're comparing it to the George Washington Bridge. It's a little footbridge. That's all it is. They're making a big thing out of this. It's going to cost over, what, 1-point-something million now? I think it's outrageous. I really do. And why don't you take somebody's advice that's experienced, like he is? He's built bridges. I mean, he might be retired now, but he still has his knowledge in his head. I don't understand why you don't listen to people like that. That built bridges, built 52 schools. I can name numerous buildings in Asbury that he built. And he's telling you about the footbridge. That's a little tiny bridge. My parents lived right across the street from that bridge for 22 years. I know what it's like. It's just a little, it's bigger than a dock, but that's all it is. And to think that you were gonna spend over $1 million on a footbridge, I think you should reconsider this. It's not gonna hurt anybody. You can send out the bids again, but without all those bids that would bring in big builders that are going to build the George Washington Bridge or the Verrazano Bridge or any bridge. This is a little tiny footbridge. The water doesn't even run. There's no running water. There's no waves. There's no nothing. It's just a lake that's there. And I think you should reconsider it. I don't think you should vote on this on Wednesday. This is not necessary right now. And I thought that all five of you sitting up there were here to save money for all of us taxpayers. So far, we haven't seen any savings. I mean, all we see is taxes going up. And I think this is one thing you should really look at and change the bids. Because the bid only wants you to get somebody that's built the two bridges, according to the letter. I only read the letter. I haven't spoken to Henry. But I know Henry, and I think it's important that you look at it. The railings are going to cost $150,000. It's not right. It really isn't right, and you've got to look at it. You can't vote on this on Wednesday. Wow. Got an answer?
Okay. I owed you 15 seconds. You got something?
What?
I owed you 15 seconds.
Okay. I'm asking you to reconsider this. Because,
okay.
I mean, like, it's not an emergency.
It's not an emergency. Okay, now you're done. It's not an emergency, but it's something that has to be done. And Mr. Vaccaro approached us and asked for us to delay the bidding for 2 weeks so he could put in a bid.
Right.
We didn't have to do that, and we did it.
I know you did.
And he did not submit a bid. So
well,
we
because
keep
he couldn't
delay in, until he can submit a bid, or else somebody's going to be in trouble. So we think it's the right thing to do. We had many people bid on it. The prices all came within range.
It's also reimbursable by FEMA.
Right.
Right.
Not the $150,000 that you're going to borrow.
Yes, it is. Everything is correct. Everything. Soft costs, hard costs, everything. 90% reimbursable. So say it's $1 million. We get 90% reimbursable. That's $900,000. So it costs $100,000 to get a new footbridge.
And we're saving you $900,000, Rita.
And I agree with you. It's not the Goldfields
it's
Bridge.
It's a glorified dock.
Rita, it costs us $300,000 to take it down. So do you want to spend $300,000 with no reimbursement to take it down, or $100,000 to have a new footbridge? So to me, it's a pretty simple answer. And again, he asked for a two-week delay, and we granted the two-week delay so he could get his financing in order to bid on it. We cannot delay it anymore. I think, and I know you're just being, like me, kind of helter-skelter tonight. To say, like, this council has produced no savings is totally irresponsible. I mean, every meeting we report how much we've saved on or added to by upping the escrow amounts, by upping the construction fees, by upping the mercantile license. So whenever I hear something like that, that just drives like a stake through my heart that says we're not being fiscally responsible. I think it's the most fiscally responsible council ever. So much where I am a cheap you know what, and I get beat up because we want to do the same thing you want to do. And as far as the beach reports, as far as revenue, would you bear with me just because I'm superstitious? A couple years ago, somebody asked the same question, and we reported the beach reports. And we were ahead at that point of the game. And we said, oh, we're ahead $200,000. And the next 3 weekends, it rained. So bear with me. We're ahead of last year. And at the end of the year, you'll get a complete breakdown week by week and everything, but let's not jinx it and get 3 weeks of rain, because 3 weeks of rain will put us backwards instead of forward. So Michael said, that's my thing, and if I'm wrong, I'm wrong, but I'll be damned if we release it if it rains. Rita, I'm coming to your house.
But what difference does it make? If we know it rains for 3 weeks, we know that the revenue would be down. I mean, we're not dumb.
Why chance it? It happened once.
You're supposed to be transparent, remember?
Okay, file an OPRA request. File an OPRA request.
Next.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Tara Weldon, and I own Hot Mess Studio on Cookman Avenue. And I apologize, I came in a little bit late today. I thought the meeting started at 7, so I'm kind of blindly going on what was spoken about before I got here. What I wanted to talk to you about tonight is spot zoning 600 Cookman Avenue to consider moving my hair salon into that space. I'm so nervous, I'm sorry. okay. I'm trying. You're so good at this. I remember coming to the Asbury Park Boardwalk when I was a little girl in my Easter bonnet for the Easter parade, and I can remember riding the carousel and not being big enough to reach for the gold ring. But I can remember for as far back as I can, just wanting to be a part of something here and the magic of this city. And I feel like 8 years ago, I took a chance, and there was a tumbleweed blowing down the street, and it was the best decision of my life. I have an amazing business. I met the love of my life, who's also a business owner here in the city, and we inspire each other every day, and we want to continue to grow in this city and grow as part of the community. I host a few charity events, one for Kentucky Derby at the Watermark, and one this year, it was the first year, it was a pink party to raise money for Mary's Place in Ocean Grove, which is the Women's Cancer Rehabilitation Center. And I feel like by being able to grow my business and expand into a bigger space, I'm hopefully helping develop the community. I know we have a lot of bars and restaurants, but what I want to do is I want to bring hundreds of clients here a week during the day to shop and to visit our city. I also have a very, very large wedding business. I do over 50 weddings a year. And all those bridal parties and their families and people from out of town are coming here to see me and my team at my studio. And they're spending money. They're parking, they're out shopping, they're buying things, and I think it would be a really great thing. So I ask you to please consider this because I want to continue to be part of the fabric of this city.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Motion to close.
Move it.
Second. All in favor?
Yes.
Motion to adjourn.
Move it.
Second.
Does she do that?
We have 15 minutes.